So we have one speaker, very distinguished one, Maximo Torredo from IFPRI, one of the partners of the project. He's going to do the main presentation and he's going, I think, to summarize a whole bunch of research that the project has been doing on this very important topic. So please, Maximo.
Thank you very much, Luca. So what I'm going to present a little bit is issues on price, prices and price volatilities, and try to a little bit understand what we have learned from the past and see how we can move forward in several topics. So the first thing to bring, which is a little bit different, if you recall the graph that was shown in the morning, no? It was in nominal prices, no? And there you saw a big spike in terms of nominal prices in 2007, 2008. This is in real terms, so it's a real price evolution, which basically we look at relative prices, so that's what we want to look. And what we observe here is that what happened in the period of 2007, 2008, it was not by far the highest issue in terms of real price spikes, which was what normally we are afraid in terms of consumers, because the price goes up in real terms. I can buy less, or I will affect my consumer surplus. It was one important price spike in terms of real terms, but there were many others that were higher in the 70s, even in the 80s, that what happened in there. So the message there is that policies that were exactly related to price spikes, not necessarily could be the way to go in this situation, and we need to look at what else was happening, because something was happening that was restricting the access to food, which was the problem that we were observing in those periods. So to be able to do that, we have been working on developing a way in which we can create a metric of what we call volatility, and specifically excessive volatility. So what this graph is showing is the count of days that we call excessive volatile days across time. And basically what we want to observe is how many of those days were present in those periods of time. And we can go backwards and forward. I just plot from 2002, and it goes up to 2015, 2016 even. If we go into the last years, in 2016, there was only a small 3 days of excessive price volatility for soybeans. If you recall, a few weeks ago, soybeans had some significant volatility, and we captured that even 30 or 60 days in advance. So the model, basically what it does, it predicts non-parametrically the changes in prices, because we're measuring volatility, log returns, and we then identify the 95 percentile. So what is the 5% probability that a rare event of changes in prices will happen? So if the event happens, means that I go over this 95 percentile, meaning that this rare event is happening in terms of volatility. And that's what we label as excessive volatility. So it's a statistical definition of the threshold. The threshold can be made more endogenous, like for example, when volatility really matters for poverty or things like that, but still we are not there. At this point, at least to be able to compare across years, we have made this definition with this non-parametric flexible model that allows us to capture the number of days. We can do exactly the same under. So this is for high levels of changes. We can do exactly the same for the lower part, so the 5% percentile, and seeing how many days of very low price volatility we're observing because of soybean. So if we look at this graph and we look at all the commodities, we will observe that there is a massive amount of days in this period of time of excessive price volatility. Remember, this is very rare. These are extreme events. And the reason why we call it excessive is because farmers are used to volatile markets, seasonality, and so on and so forth. So they know how to cope with that. But when we arrive to these excessive levels of volatility, this is something that farmers are not aware, they don't know how to handle. It's something too extreme for them. And therefore, it will be very difficult for them to make decisions on production, on what to produce and when to sell, because they don't have a clear idea at all of what will be the changes in prices over time. And remember, this is done every day. So we every day calculate this and estimate this number of excessive days of volatility. So just to summarize the message here, is that clearly 2007 and 2008 across all commodities, because there were in 2004 some extreme values in terms of soybeans, but all the commodities show this massive amount of excessive volatility in that period of time, which later on started to dissipate, and which we have not observed in the last 3 years. Now, why is this so important? Because if we relate this to the portfolio of commodities, as I was explaining before, basically, we have very few countries which are the ones that manage most of the exports in the world of these commodities. So if I look at wheat, I look at corn, maize, and I look at soybeans and rice, the top four or top five countries will control more than 60% of the share of exports. So if anything happens in any of these four countries over the space of the world, then automatically it will affect. And the same happens if I look at the import market. we have a huge importer, which is China, and other big countries which control most of the imports. So basically, our global portfolio is very vulnerable to any potential shock in the weather. And that will be reflected immediately into the second moment, which is volatility. Now, climate change complicates this even more. So as we know, there is not necessarily consensus that temperature regions will have increased variability in temperature and rainfall. There is no consensus on tropical regions, but there is an increased mean in temperature. So basically what we are observing is a shift of the distribution from less cold weather to more record hot weather. But the second thing that we are observing in all these scenarios is an increase in the variance. So we will have more frequent shocks around the space because of climate change. And that's directly related to the problem that I was referring before of volatility. And even if we start to look at the different modeling, so here we have all the impact of climate change scenarios over global yields. That's the first column in each of the graphs. The area of production and the prices, depending on the shares of economic pathway or the representative concentration pathway that we look, we will see significant differences depending on the scenario. Even look at the SSP3, the variance that we observe in the price is significant. Okay? So the message is, no matter, we are not necessarily to look to the mean, but what we are going to observe in the information that we have today is this increasing variance of the information that is being transmitted, and therefore we need to be careful about it because that could be immediately reflected in volatility. Now, what happened in the 2007? And what I did is I looked at all the literature that was written for the 70s, which was this huge real price spike. Okay? And this is a picture of some of the books and papers that came out of that, which basically they were trying to cope with this increase in prices, the significant shift in real prices that happened in the 70s. And then I tried to compare that with what was proposed as a result of the 2007, 2008, or 2009. And basically all the proposals, with one or two exceptions, were identical, essentially, with some variations, but all of them were basically the same. No? Food reserves, price controls, price stability, the sport facility was also there in the 70s. And there were all of these list of potential recommendations that were very similar to the ones we were observing later after the 2007, 2008. Now, what was the problem with that? Is that those recommendations, at least in my understanding, were developed for a price spike. And they were not necessarily developed to cope with a second moment, which is the variance of increasing volatility. And my comment there is, okay, how we can do to improve that, and what we can do to be able to try to resolve that and try to cope with that reality, which was there. And that's something to assess carefully and try to see what really was happening and how we can really tackle the problem that was behind, which was this potential problem of excessive volatility, which is because of this increase in market concentration of the export market and the import market, because of the linkages with the energy sector, which also move in and back the relationship with the oil prices, which not necessarily is only oil to food, but also food to oil. And also because of the interlinkages with the financial sector at a certain point, which not necessarily was bad because speculation is good, but also because it could exacerbate extreme situations. So when you are already in a period of excessive volatility where there is asymmetry of information, huge asymmetry, then it could be an entry to more of this activity which could exacerbate the situation, and also because of all these, the secondary effects of the trade policy. And this is just to show basically this idea of the effect of the trade policy. So basically what we had is a natural shock in the 2007, which could represent an increase in 10% of the prices. But then there were tons of policies related to trade issues that, for example, export taxes to mitigate the shock, effects in decrease of import duties to mitigate the shock in domestic markets, and the interaction effect. And that exacerbated the problem to double. Rather than reducing the problem, it increased the problem. And I have a very clear example of today. So I was in the Argentinian exchange looking at what was the forecast for Argentina. Argentina was one of the countries that imposed a huge export tax because they wanted to collect revenue because of the high prices on wheat, maize, and soybeans. So if we look today at what the U.S. is being producing in basic staples, because of the low prices and the lower volatility, the U.S. is settling down, and the farmers are getting more debt, which means they're going into a tougher period. The U.S. have higher yield, higher productivity than Argentina. Okay? So what you will expect is Argentina to follow the same path. But when we look what Argentina is doing because of the change in the policy, they reduce export tax to wheat and maize, they immediately create a supply chain, significant supply chain. Argentina is one of the key players in the export market. So what will happen to these producers is that the price will continue to fall. And then they will be faced with lower profits. because they are low elites. Now, of course, we have to put in context that Argentina still have a relative prices problem, so it could be that part of this surplus of production could go to ethanol production in Argentina. But again, it's clearly showing how still the markets are asymmetric and how we need to look at those. The other important issue that we need to figure out, and this is basically the evolution of the amount of share of produced calories crossing international borders. And they have been significantly increasing over time, which means we convert everything here into calories, means that the mobility of goods seems to be the trend, and we need to work over that realization. That's why any policy against flow of goods could create an exacerbated problem, and that's something that we need to put into context when we look at this topic. Now, what are the four key messages? And I'm only going to focus at the global level. We have a lot more work that was presented before, in the session before, but also in the reports, looking at the country level. So the first one of the recommendations that were implemented in many countries as a result of the 2007-2008 were the physical reserve as a buffer stock. So how we can use reserves, physical reserves, as a way to stabilize prices. And there was a presentation before looking at how we can have a proper policy of reserve storage. But basically, the position that, or what we learned looking at many of the issues, is what are the layers that we need to look at, why we need to be worried about this, okay? So one is how you define the optimal stock. And you can have a stocking rule that it was presented in the session before. But again, in a country that doesn't have the institutional capacity to do that, this could create a lot of issues of corruption and so on and so forth. And that's the experience that we have faced in other countries, in developing countries. So how we can do that, how we can predict demand and supply, where potential shortfalls in the market can be extremely difficult to identify, especially in a world of huge uncertainty and extreme volatility. And also we need to have transparent and accountable governance rules. So if we don't have those minimum conditions, it would be very difficult to put in place something like this. And we have seen many failures, and still we see enormous amount of reserves with huge losses that we need to look in carefully. The second one is the level of cost and losses of the reserves, because clearly there is a cost. We have a loss because of the deterioration of the commodity, and it costs money. And we need to figure out how we can minimize those costs, how we can have the proper rotation of that reserve to be able to minimize that cost. And that requires releasing, buying and selling. And the rule should include that element, because you want to minimize the potential losses. And one way to do it is to bring the private sector, but it depends how developed your private sector is in the country, and that could put a lot of constraints. And finally is how many uncertainties are that the strategic reserve can bring about marketplace. So could they distort markets or not? What type of distortion, what's the level of distortion that they will create? So there, a link to this is a triggering mechanism, no? When I release, when I don't release them, and for what I'm going to use them, no? Now, one alternative to this has been the regional reserves. And the advantage of the regional reserves is that I can combine several countries and try to cope and diversify my risk. And also helps a lot institutionally, because I can control the fixed cost and the probability of having a better rotation to minimize losses is better. But again, we need to have, although they have the benefit of to cope better risk, also can reduce all the fixed costs, still have some risks, no? Requires important cooperation to avoid capture of the bigger countries in the region. Requires clear trigger definition, and requires clear rules of pricing and delivery, at what price I buy and at what price I sell. This reserve to cope with problem of access, or this reserve is to stabilize prices across the region. Okay, what we have seen that it works to cope with problems of access, especially for safety nets, when you have a developed safety net system. But again, you need to have also a clear rule of replenishment. No? So the rules and the mechanisms are very important, and the institutional design behind those are important. We have two examples, the Asian Plus 3, which used to have a very nice, clear trigger based on weather conditions, which now is deviating a little bit. And then the ECOWAS, which is still in the process. It has progressed, it has some ruling. There has been a lot of discussion. The European Commission has been supporting technically that. But still, I think, institutionally, we need to figure out how to set up a mechanism like this that could minimize the risk of having country-level reserves. The second one is on trade facilitation. And we know that pro-trade policies could improve availability of food quantity. It could be at a lower price because I could gain the comparative advantage of the different countries, and can also improve quality if I have standards measures that will allow me to do that. But we also need to understand that openness creates winners and losers, no? Which is an important issue to look at it, and it could increase inequalities. So how we can resolve and cope with that, I think, is really important, and how we can have redistributive policies and safety nets in place to minimize those issues. And then we have The second level of issues that also start to increase significantly after 2007, which is this idea of foreign direct investment versus land grabbing. No, and one thing that there are some rules now put in place by the CFS, but one thing that we learn from this is that we need to learn from other sectors substantially, because we are talking of land that could lose its capacity. It's similar to mining, okay? And we have learned enormous amount of technology on how to regulate foreign direct investment in those type of extractive industries. But we never brought those type of knowledge to agriculture. And it's something to look at carefully, how we can control for those type of different types of investment, because FDI in agriculture could be extremely good. It's just an issue of how small countries can have systems in place to properly regulate so that we get the returns, the proper returns of FDI. Now, the importance of openness and trade, I think especially for Africa, where we're talking of tripling trade through the Malabo Declaration, is basically not reflected in what we see in average tariffs, both in calories and in proteins. The heterogeneity of the level of tariffs across many countries in Africa shows a huge heterogeneity problem, which makes it very difficult to create this interregional trade, which is the only way you can make this idea of tripling trade and assure mobility of goods. So that's something to look at carefully and try to find ways in which the regions can coordinate better and standardize the way to move across countries the commodity. And related to this is the access to transportation costs. If I do a similar graph looking at the transportation cost of moving calories from one location to the other, again, we see significant heterogeneity among the different countries in the world. That's something to look at. The third message is more on information and transparency and regulation of future exchanges. This was something very discussed in that period of time because there was this issue of speculation. And really, there was no consensus. There was a group that was saying speculation is good, and there was a group that was saying speculation is the evil of the game. And really, I think the situation was in the middle. My perception, at least, and the work we did was that speculation in certain periods of time, especially in the times where we have significant excessive volatile days, was problematic because it was exacerbating the situation. No, it was increasing the velocity of movement without the commodity, because you can do buys and sells without settling. So that created an exacerbation, but it was not across all the period. So for a specific, very small periods of time, we found some statistical significance of that, but again, these were basically associations, correlations. These were not causal because of the limitation of the data. And it's very difficult to track the stocks in the world because you have stocks even in the sea. And private companies store and private people store. So it's very difficult to see if you really are using stocks for speculating or not. We found when looking at the long trend that at certain points in time, yes, there was some overpricing because there were more stocks than what there was supposed to be at that level of price. But again, the problem is that what we do, okay? And during the Paris G20 and later on, there was a lot of discussion, okay, we can limit the volume of speculation, but we can also make delivery on contracts portions compulsory so that they have to put money to avoid this just winning in and out of sectors that were working in the exchange, which were not traditional of this type of commodities. You can impose additional capital deposits. What we found is that it requires several conditions to be effective. First, it's not a binding regulation. Triggers were not activated, and also the one that exists in terms of the limits never worked properly in terms of triggering when they were supposed to trigger, if we correlate that with excessive volatility days. And second one, which I thought was the biggest problem, is that we found significant linkages between exchanges. So for example, if I was able to put a significant regulation in Chicago Exchange, and I didn't regulate the other exchanges, the effect will go through the others, and then affect the situation at the same time. So what that means for us means that you need to get into a consensus of regulators and governments. And that would not happen. No, that's a global problem which is more common. So this put a lot of constraints in the way we can do this type of things. But what we found is that better information on reserves and key staples could help. And that was the idea of creating the AMIS, the Agricultural Market Information System. And that's where we wanted to find ways to improve and to link that to early warning systems of excessive volatility and on price spikes and to better forecast price and volatility. AMIS have progressed, but still we are not there. We still miss an enormous amount of information of bigger countries with reserves like India and China. But that's a way to go in terms of delivery of public information of the level of stocks so that we are better informed. And when we see some nervousness in the market, we know that the stocks are there, and therefore we don't need to overreact to those type of changes. And the last one, and I finish, is this important thing that we are not carefully looking at. How important is the level of uncertainty farmers are facing. Basically, we need to find ways to cope with that risk and to develop a set of tools that will help to cope and to live under uncertainty. As I mentioned earlier, farmers are facing risks in terms of prices, like any other commodity. They face risk in terms of input prices too, because the input industry is extremely concentrated in the case of agriculture. They face risk in terms of weather, and they face risk in terms of oil prices and energy prices because of the interlinkages. So they really live under this huge uncertainty, and they have to make decisions of investment. So it's the sector where information, like good information on weather, forecasting information, crop calendars, and market intelligence is crucial, and at the same time, insurance tools that will allow them to better diversify and cope with the risk. Thank you.
Thanks, Maximo. So now I leave the floor to a second shorter presentation by another partner of the Food Security Project, the JRC in Seville, and the presentation is going to be made by Pierre Boulanger, and he's also a partner that did some significant work on this issue during the project.
Thank you. Thank you. So good morning, my name is Pierre Boulanger. I work for the JRC, Institute of Sustainable Resources, Economics of Agriculture Units. My intervention will be very brief. I'd just like to introduce three tools developed by the JRC in order to have a better information and forecast. The first one, that maybe you know, is probably to the AMIS initiative that Maximo just mentioned, is the AgriForecast. AgriForecast from the Marsunion unit, and to provide a yield forecast for the European Union and for the main producing region of the world. So getting this forecast during the growing season allows, if necessary, very quick policy intervention, if it is justified, and also in terms of budget preparation for the EU, for the CAP, overview of the budget possibilities. These data are then transferred to the AMIS, and then it's a contribution of the European Union on this. Also, the AgriForecast initiative, which ideally should be a global AgriForecast initiative, already cooperate with some regional initiatives like the MedAmin, Amin for Trust. And the idea is that in the Mediterranean Basin, which is a key importer of cereal, especially Egypt, for instance, we share the experience of the forecast with the extension. Second initiative is the contribution of the European Market Outlook, agricultural market outlook, done by DG Agri, and with the support of the GRC, which aim to provide an outlook for the next 10 years for the European markets. The EU is not the only one to do such output. There is also one done by the FAOCD, one from the USDA, from FAPRI. Nevertheless, for now 2 years, the European Commission is supporting an African-led network of research institute training to do an African market outlook. So the name is RENAPRI, that maybe you already heard about this initiative. We now gather 9 African countries, and within 2 weeks, they will present in Nairobi their new market outlook for the Southeast African region. And the third initiative I would like briefly to introduce is an initiative done by the European Commission and the African Development Bank called African Food Price Collection. The idea of the initiative is that within about 150 African markets, which cover almost all African countries, we have collectors who, through a mobile phone and application, take the price every week of about 25 commodities to put a price on the mobile phone, which is sent to a server, which is treated, and then you can see the evolution of the price of these 20-25 commodities in 150 markets in Africa. And this type of data is then freely available on the web, and it can be a good instrument also for policy makers in terms of everyone. African free price collection. So if you put in Google, you will be right on the website. Of course, then the data are made freely available. I will stop here. I think it has the three main initiatives that which are related with the topic of this session.
So, now we are open to discussion. If any. Sorry, yes, perhaps it's a good idea if you look at the flow when you answer. I think that we already have a question by
Sanseli. So I have a question for you. To run any stock policy, you obviously need first to have some ways of estimating the optimal policy or rules. Mm-hmm. And that, as you know, is quite difficult because the one thing that is almost always neglected and is very difficult is the behavior of the private sector that basically counteracts the public policy. And my question is this, all this, I have not seen a single country that has done a proper job of trying to estimate the rules or the optimal stocks, you know, in any one particular year through a model. I'm not saying it's easy, but nobody has done it. The second is, and they need to do it if they want to apply some of the things that you're talking about.
I did it.
Are you sure?
So I know what you're doing. But I can explain you what you're doing. Sorry.
But anyway, you did it for India, if I recall.
Yeah.
But
I can explain you the one I know that somehow did it.
No, I've done it too, but it's very difficult. Second is, if you want to talk about regional policies, my second point is that to assess the storage policy, you need, of course, to know the policy. Because most people think that optimal stocks is just a certain amount of stocks, which is totally wrong. You need to have a policy and then simulate the whole thing over time or somehow assess it over the risks that you are forecasting. And that very few people have done it. Maybe Christoph has done it, so he'll tell us about it. The third is the regional stocks that you were talking about. This is much more difficult because to have, first of all, you need rules for a regional stock, and rules have to depend on the production of the individual members of the region. And I have not seen anyone estimate a regionally optimal rules. Okay? What Asia does is totally nonsense. They just want to have a stock, and people, you know, like to keep a stock. They do it because to just to appear good, but it's totally ineffective and totally useless. What the African governments do, it's even more useless. And I would say most of the other countries, what they do is useless. And I'm not saying with light heart. I have something like 30, 35 years of observation of these countries, and none of them is doing anything that is any good. So now, what hope is there that they might do something better?
Okay, so we'll collect the second question by David.
So I never really did this, a lot of storage myself, but I followed it for many, many years, and it's a really important topic, I thought storage. I think that basically, if I really look what happened in other areas, there is something that you call behavioral economic, behavioral finance. You need to develop something behavioral storage. Because obviously, if you look what really happened during 2007-2008, obviously the damage was much smaller than we were afraid of. All the experts thought that the world was falling apart, and actually at the end we realized that farmers were doing better. Actually, it was good for agriculture. That was my gut feeling was in the beginning. It wasn't such a bad period. So the key question to understand what countries are doing, what are the practices that work and what the practices that didn't work. And then you can have a mechanism to say, okay, India, my government is that India is totally mismanaging to store it, and the talent did some stuff that was almost criminal. Mm-hmm. But this is intuition. If we really start not only to look at optimization, but to look at behavioral stuff, then we have something that we can really try to understand. I really don't think that you understand how behavioral people, how behavioral is happening. Secondly, when it's related to developing countries, managing COVID is really, really difficult. What type of training people have? You need to have something that will certify people to have some sort of background for storage management, because I see that a lot of times the big mistakes are done when storage is managed by amateurs. People that run storage are not PhD in economics, they don't have masters. We need to educate the country that the same way that we need an agronomy that knows what they're doing to manage the experiment there, we need someone that knows what they're doing when it comes to storage.
Yeah.
Okay,
just to stop.
Yes, Maximo, so you have told us that there are some room of improvement for ENIS. Could you tell us more about it? What kind of improvement do you think?
Okay, if I can add to this first round of questions, I think that it was kind of remarkable that we didn't have any kind of policy opening in this debate, and actually it seems that someone from the Commission told us that this issue is not so relevant anymore. And actually, your figures, Maximo, show that in recent years, no volatility. So why do we have this session at all? I think that this is an issue in terms of what we are measuring, what we have been measuring, it's ex-post volatility, realized volatility. Okay. But then people, even from the behavior point of view, could change their choices for ex-ante volatility, for the fear of volatility, even if it doesn't realize. And this could have some kind of cost and implication. So I think that already measuring volatility exposed is difficult. To measure the fear of that, perhaps it's even more challenging, but this thing is also relevant, because otherwise, this thing is always to be a sort of exposed reaction. When there is a spike, everybody starts to cry about it, but then you don't have any kind of permanent focus on the problem.
Okay, so let me go and answer all of them. So my whole issue on reserve was all the problems that are there. No, that was my slides were more on the concerns and the complexities behind, which many are being raised by you. Clearly, there are significant issues on the rules of accumulation and storage rules, both buying and selling. I think even the selling is a little bit more complex because of the triggering. So depending on for what you do the reserve, okay? So there are two ways to look at it. One is stabilization, and the other one is for safety nets, no? To basically have the enough supply to deliver to the safety nets. I found it that in the safety nets, which was more what I was referring to the regional reserve, and I can elaborate a little bit more, that could be a good mechanism to cope with the potential risk of lack of access, which is very different to the problem of stabilization, because then you have a problem, no? First, we cannot predict prices, that's clear. No? If we can predict prices, we won't be here, we'll be making a lot of money. But what we can predict is changes of prices. We can predict volatility, excessive volatility. So then the issue is how we incorporate all these elements and how much it makes sense for countries that don't have any institutional capacity, and they have no clear rules at all in anything that they do in agriculture, to build up and force them to build up a reserve, which the only thing it will do is to open a huge black box of corruption, which is what we don't want. And that's exactly what is happening in fertilizers with the subsidies of fertilizers. If you look at fertilizer across countries, all the bidding mechanisms are designed for corruption. Clearly, they are not using the latest ways of doing bidding mechanisms, they are using mechanisms that have windows across the board. So why we want to put something more in a country which doesn't have that capacity? Now, your question was, are there countries that have been trying to do that? One country that I know very well is Mexico. Why? Because Mexico is import dependent of wheat and makes for the tortillas, the famous tortillas. And Mexico was trying to develop a rule, like a kind of a dynamic price band with a kind of a quasi-parametric, non-parametric mechanism. This was done by Roberto Rigobon, no? from MIT. So basically they tried to develop a policy rule that would allow them to create a kind of a virtual mechanism, in the sense that they were buying and selling and subsidizing depending on the situation. They develop a parametric model to do that, and they failed. Basically what happened is that they were paying more than that where they were supposed to be paying, okay? And then the issue is, okay, why you were looking at local prices, because they were working in this model with local prices, when the risk was at that point international, no? And there was the issue of how they can use another mechanism to trigger the delivery of this type of virtual flows of resources rather than commodity specifically. Christoph can explain about his modeling for India, but clearly I see a lot of complexities on this, and that links to the behavioral part. No? So how we can bring behavioral reactions of the private sector that you also referred to into those ones, I have not seen something so sophisticated right now. And even, it's very complex. It could be that we can do theoretically modeling and have heterogeneous agents with different behavioral responses, but even then, it's far from implementing in the practical terms in a country that you can bring that theoretical part into the reality. Now, the reason why I brought the regional reserves, for me, was more looking like thinking of insurance, okay? So it's easier for me to cope with a region where then I will have heterogeneity, I will have more diversity, than to cope with one country on one side. The second thing is I can get some economies of scale and some cost savings because I need rotation of my reserves. But I was specifically thinking on savings, okay? Now, Asian plus three, honestly, the idea of Asian is only rice, no, essentially. But the idea of that is was a trigger on weather, extreme weather events, okay? And what they were thinking is, okay, if one of our countries get an extreme weather event and they define that extreme weather event, then this small reserve that they have, because it's very small, could help to cope with that specific variety of rice and help the release policy. So the release policy was focused on a very simple weather trigger, okay? Which I think is correct if you want to basically go with access in the short term. The problem then is that simple trigger in developed countries, basically, well, some of them, start to deteriorate now and is becoming more political. So, I mean, now Africa doesn't have regional reserve. ECOWAS is starting to set up a regional reserve, and there has been a lot of technical work to try to figure out a way to do it properly. In my experience, when we designed the idea of the ECOWAS reserve through the G20 in Paris, it was very important to understand at what price you sell, you buy. And the position there was sell and buy at the market price, because the solution was for access to safety nets and for basically to resolve the problem of lack of food in the countries. And basically the idea was if there is needed money to buy at a higher price, you have, for that you have the export facilities and so on and so forth of the IMF. But then the other issue was the rotation and how much you can minimize the loss. And that's where WFP play a role, because they have to buy and sell for what they do. And that reduced the cost of the losses, okay? With the ECOWAS thing, I hope now the design is getting better. We did a paper on that because we're working on reserves across the board, but still there is a lot, I think, to do. So again, coming back to the behavioral part, I think that's central, but we are very far from it. I think that still we are very far from it. Even we are far from the clearing mechanism. In terms of rooms for improvement for AMIS, you know, AMIS is one of the few G20 recommendations that they still move and still is progressing. AMIS have two elements, the AMIS as market information system, and then they have the rapid response forum, which is basically for the shops. When there is a problem in the market, there is a forum that meets of the key exporting and importing countries, and technical people try to come and calm the market if it's really no reason to exacerbate the market. And it has worked, in some cases it worked in 2011, in other cases, still we don't know because we have not been facing those alarms right now. But what is the progress right now? Our rapid response forum is developing a control panel where they are bringing all the different tools that are around and trying to see consistency across them. Because the messages were very different. You have an index from the World Bank, an index from HAL, an index from IPRI, and right now we're trying to find ways in which, instead of having one, we have a set of lights. No? And we have like 7 indicators. And a big amount of them have to flash red so that we say something. Because it's very difficult to have only one indicator. So let's play with several ones, and that's one thing that they are doing. Where I think they need a lot more progress yet is on the stocks, and understanding the level of the stocks in the world. And I don't know if that is feasible also, because right now the focus is more on countries, and still there is a problem with China and India in terms of delivery of the information, which are key importing countries and exporting countries. So still there is a lot to reduce that. So why it's so important? Because the idea was if we know how much stocks you have in the world, and then you see an abnormality in the price, and, for example, one of these excessive days, and you have enough stocks, you can come out and say, look at it. Yeah, there was an abnormality because there was a drought in this country, which was a key exporter, but there is enough stocks to smooth out. And the market should react faster. So it was basically a way to reduce asymmetry of information to make markets react. So still, there is a lot to do there, and there is nothing done in the private sector side, which could be important in terms of stock and storage. And finally, regarding why we should have this meeting, honestly, I think that it was a mistake by the Commission. respect, but I don't see that the problem has been resolved. If you look at the market, the structure of commodities, it still is problematic, highly concentrated. If you look at the market structure of the import markets, it's even worse. For example, now we have a challenge with Brazil. We don't know what will happen in Brazil once the fiscal problems start to trigger and the subsidies start to reduce many of the things that they are doing. And Brazil is a key exporter of soybeans and maize and wheat. So I don't see that the linkages with energy has been changed. You see what is happening now with the oil prices because of the reduction of production of Russia. So it moved to 50 the barrel. So it was very low and stable. That's why we didn't see the transmission too much to the food market. So for me, it's unless something has changed substantially, you see the issue of exports and the movement of goods and how we have heard a lot of protectionist talk in the last days. Even the same parties that proposed the TTIP are now going against the TTIP. So there are all the things that we are, all the signals that we are seeing there, for me, reflect what we faced in that period of time. So it's just an issue of seeing what will happen if there is a shock or a drought or a climate shock in any of these key exporting countries and see if we move again to the same type of days. Now, the capacity we have, the data we have for the model that we have for our volatility only give us a capacity to predict 90 days in advance. So this is prediction. This is not a past forecast. So okay. We don't wait for the day to measure. We predict the day. And for example, we were very successful in predicting the 3 days of excessive volatility of soybeans that happened in the last 2 months or something like that. So, but it's very limited, no? And this requires high frequency data. So we are working with daily, which we don't find at the country level. That's why we cannot replicate something similar.
Just
give
the possibility to
actually, no, when Maxime was speaking, I was thinking on the EPS, the Economic Partnership Agreement, that the EU is either trying to sign or to ratify. And I was wondering in which extent this EPA can contribute to limit price volatility. And also, if I'm right, this Monday, has been starting an EPA with the Sub-Saharan African Development Community. And for the first time in a regional trade agreement, it is mentioned that the EU is forbidden to any export to be found. And they try to put some commitments on limiting some trade policy sanctions. So I know which extent this EPA could be able to
So you have so more questions rather than providing answers. So there is one that didn't touch before. Okay, so yeah, follow up from
the follow up. I think there has always been a serious perception problem from the viewpoint of politicians, and many times from economists as well. People confuse the stocks needed for safety and for what you called it something.
Price stabilization?
Eh?
Price stabilization?
No.
Safety nets, you mean?
The safety.
The yes. Humanitarian.
The safety stocks. Whether it's humanitarian or for something else, but it's safety stocks. And I will say in a minute that these are very well defined and they can easily be specified. Price stabilization stocks are a real Pandora's box. I believe they are everywhere they have been tried, they have problems because of triggers, because of the people who manage them that don't know what to manage, from the reactions of the private sector. You have a host of problems. Countries do it, or policymakers do it, because they think they can control the markets. And they have lost every single time. They cannot control the markets, period. But I don't think that lesson gets to them. However, the food safety stocks serve a totally different persons, and they are defined not in terms of rules, but in terms of stocks. What are they? They are basically stocks that are not supposed to be used as a glove. They are supposed to be used only when you anticipate some supplies to come, let's say in a country like Somalia or Eritrea, and you have a problem, and you say, I need 3 months worth of supplies before the other supplies come. And you don't have it from anywhere, so then you draw down your stocks. This is exactly a safety net. And you can do this on a regional level, on a country level, and on a global level. And the calculations are not difficult. And I don't think if ECOWAS is focusing on that, that's what they should focus on. Not on the stabilization thing, which is a totally impossible thing to manage, both theoretically as well as in actual thing. So, and I think one of the things maybe the project should emphasize as a policy thing is that this separation, and if you have enough guts, say that don't do the stabilization thing, do only the safety net thing.
Yeah. I actually continue with that. I really think the question is, what next? So first I said, I've been working with water. And generally speaking, after 3 years after a drought, people forget about water shortages, and then 5 years later, you have a more severe drought. But to some extent, periods where you really don't have volatility are periods to think about what you do about it. So I think in this regard, what we do now is useful. Now, I agree with the record that generally price stabilization policy hasn't really been very useful. Again, it really worthwhile to study what have been the actual exposed cost of price, lack of price stabilization versus the benefit. My gut feeling is that the social net loss from stabilization has been huge because of the process maximum rates, that they are a really important mechanism to develop corruption. The other thing that is really important to look how the stabilization affects increase supply. Because to me, if you look at least at the history of US ag that I know, every time that you have a high period of prices, that's when you have a renewed in the productive capacity. That's what happened in 2008. When you really look at inventory without looking at the supply response that you trigger, you miss 90% of the data.
I can add on this before giving you the floor. I got the impression that there is a lot of focus on the possible effectiveness of policies, but what about the efficiency? So some kind of basic calculation about the cost or benefit of price changes and the cost or benefit, the cost in the case of the stabilization, should be done. Yeah. And I mean, all this kind of issue in terms of statistical measurement, no? Where is information, is noise, this kind of price changes? I think that in this respect, there is another session going on about climate change. So can we draw in this analogy between prevention and mitigation? Do we want to really avoid something, or we put something more effective to have some kind of damage control at cost?
So let me first start why we did this modeling for accessibility, because our understanding when we had these huge discussions with the G20, I think you were not longer there, you were still, well, you were still, there was a huge confusion of what volatility was. It was crazy. People were confusing prices with volatility, which is changes in return. So that was why we need to come up with something that really creates a definition, which is not perfect because it's statistical. It's not, the model is really good, but the definition is statistical, which we would love to have a trigger, which is not a 95 percentile, which is a statistical position, but more, okay, when really it affects people. We have a paper in the book that we did that looks at the effects over consumers of volatility because it's looking at the second moment, it's not looking at the direct effect. And we find in some countries that there is this. So the level of noise in this sector is huge. Okay, lack of definition, that was one which is good. I fully agree that we need to look at both efficiency and effectiveness of policy. Why I think it's important to look at efficiency? Because there are so many things that has been recommended. I have a chapter in the book that came out of this project, looking at what the World Bank was saying should be done in the research department and what the operations department was doing, okay? And the result was, this was an external evaluation of all the programs during that period, that it was the opposite, basically. So if they were saying we shouldn't be doing reserves, they were supporting reserves through budget support. If they were saying you should be doing export bonds, indirectly they were supporting subsidies to imports and so on. But anyway, so the important thing is, I think, to come up with what is there and to learn what worked, what didn't work is important. There is a whole book on the reserves in Africa showing all the problems that you mentioned, and I fully agree with you. All my recommendations are on safety, okay? Now, even say that, it's not easy. It's not as easy as you said. Of course, it's stopping, but assume that you do it regionally, the ECOWAS, you have several countries that are applying for it. And if all of them or several of them got the job, you don't have enough in the reserves to satisfy all of them. So you need to have a rule. okay, who gets it first and why and so on, and that's what we call the trigger. And there are two different triggers. No? There is the international one, which was the 207 and 208, and then there could be the local one, which is another issue, and that's where we have a lot of problems in data availability, which you are trying to improve on that, but still there is a huge gap of data, which the problem is it will never exist, because the time series that we need in the past will never exist at the frequency we need. So we need to figure out a way to do it forward and go around and see how we can do the triggers without the data, because I cannot replicate this type of models that requires a lot of data, because I will never have the data. I will have to wait 20 years to get the data I need. So we need to find other alternatives to do that, and that's where we are breaking our brains. But we should do cost effectiveness measures. Now, for me, so I fully agree with both of you, but for me, the problem right now, what I try to end my presentation, is that in climate change, you face exactly the same thing, and that's what the drawings are showing. Everybody has different scenarios, and you model the scenarios, and the results are very different. So what I will tell you as a producer, go to the highest scenario or to the lowest scenario. The interval of confidence can go from minus something to plus something, okay? And forget fisheries, which is also affected by climate change. It's another nightmare, because fish can move from one border to the other. So again, that type of information is really not useful for a person that is making decisions. Okay, so how we can improve the way we present information in a way that could be useful. So there are right now countries like Colombia, which is switching coffee areas of production, assuming certain levels of climate change in the areas they are today, so they are prepared. I think that's a huge mistake, because they really don't know what will happen. There is no way I can come up with an average scenario that will tell me basically what to do, and they're investing tons of money doing that. So again, it's a complex thing that we need to be very careful. But my position is we need tools. Okay? Farmers need tools to cope with risk, and we don't have those tools. In most of the developing countries, we don't have at all tools. We don't have insurance. The level of access to insurance is extremely low. Of course, developed countries have, but with huge subsidies. How we can make commercial insurance or catastrophic insurance to work in these countries, okay? We don't have even markets, future markets, for them to be able to cope or to hedge, whatever. And they don't have the knowledge to be able to do that. They are not used to do that, okay? How we set up those institutionalities to have that in place. So for me, it's more, if I am going to make decisions under what I put in Pindic and Rubenfield book, if I'm going to make decisions under uncertainty, I need to have tools that will allow me to set up my portfolio and in a way that I minimize my expected risk. I could fail, but at least I have the tools. And right now, those are missing across the board. That's a little bit my way of thinking.
Yeah?
Oh, the APA, sorry. I hope if the APA partnership agreements, the European partnership, start to move, that will allow mobility of food and commodities across the board. So it should help to reduce the problem of access, no? But again, if you look at the trends in nominal rates of protection, for example, you will see that in Latin America, they are starting to go up, which is kind of inconsistent. Okay, in developed countries, they are going down, so which is consistent to type of EPA agreements and trying to move goods across trade. But I don't know how much they will really become effective in the partnership that they will do with the countries. And we do a lot of work in the modeling exercises to try to model the positives and negatives of all of these agreements, and especially the distributional effects. No? So that's something that we need to look at.
That is not the right frame to cope with.
It's one of the multiple frames. I don't think it's the solution for everything. I think creating increasing openness to trade allow more to think of a world in which you can move commodities, which you need, because not all the countries will have the same comparative advantage as I put in increasing access to trade. But I don't think that will resolve all the problems. It's basically one of the elements that need to be in place to assure mobility of food.
Okay, Steve, just to follow up on that, no? I mean, this kind of debate about volatility, international trade always has a kind of a negative accent, so that it's the source of the problem. Well, actually, it's also part of the solution. I mean, uncertainty is part of life. So, what is the counterfactual? It's not a world without uncertainty. It would be that under autarky, would be extreme, would be less uncertain, less volatile, you would have all the domestic shocks that only be solved. So,
it's the opposite.
The more free trade you have, the
less. Yes, but this kind of thing in the debate is not pointed out, I think.
No, I think that the position. No. So, there are two elements, okay? Yeah. One is clearly what I'm arguing is if I am autarky and I have all these shocks, I will be destroyed because I don't have a way to access the goods. So, trade will supposed to cope and diversify your portfolio as a country, okay? That's one side of the story. The other side is the politics, which is linked to what you were saying on the reserves and so on and so forth. You know, in my reports, I always say these reserves are useless and we have all these problems. Don't use it for price stabilization because it's very complex even to figure out what to stabilize, because price bands, no matter how sophisticated you do, you always pay. The problem is that you have countries with these things in place already. So it's not as easy as to tell them close. So our job has been, okay, how we can help to improve so that you can phase out of this process through better techniques and so on and so forth. Because it's, politics are always there, no? And it's very easy, difficult to say, forget about politics and do the technical thing. So I think we need to find ways to move them out. But the idea of, which is basically the idea of self-sufficiency of autarky, I think is the wrong way to go. And I think there is enough evidence now that we can simulate what are the wrongs and the potential problems of that. Given say that we know that trade is creates inequality, so how we can have policies to minimize those potential distributional effects, which is the problem. Normally we don't do that. So we do the agreements and so on and so forth, but we don't look at what are the potential, who are the winners and who are the losers.
That is
still
1 minute.
I really think that trade is probably the only, the main solution for it. Now if you look at it historically, about 150 years ago, people were dying in France during starvation because they didn't have mechanism to move transport from one place to another. I think that our biggest challenge is to educate the general public about trade, not with mathematical model, but with basically with stories and to illustrate how important it is. Because the loser from trade will always make much more noise than the benefit.
But the other thing that you need to, if you look at trade, is also transportation costs, no?
Sure.
And that's a huge investment. So the temporality is important, and because you need to reduce the data originated transportation costs to be able to move trade as you would like to do.
Okay, we are perfectly on time. Thanks a lot to everybody for coming here and giving us